Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hero Killer, a lit RPG adventure by Ned Caratacus. Narrated by PJ Ochlan. Prologue. Load selected file. In the Aresian Empire, in the distant world of Luminar, where everyone and their dad is an aspiring adventurer, the most common cause of death is no hit points, and a monster invasion means just another day off work or school. For over 5,000 years, the Jade Crown's curse kept the world in a stranglehold of dark lords, chosen heroes, and senseless destruction. To lift the curse would be to disrupt the balance of good and evil, bringing untold chaos and death to the four province kingdoms of Ares.
Ovinium, the gods-fearing heartland of forests and prairies. Celsior, the industrial juggernaut ruled by the demented King Gregor. Dungate, the dry and dusty homeland of the dwarves. And Rosencrace, the snow-covered, war-torn country of the elves.
Yes, those four, thank you. The imperial government maintained that this cycle of death was unavoidable. In truth, House Koschei, the family of undead trillionaires that control Celsior, used the destruction caused by the cycle to advance their own mysterious plans. And it worked. Until Erasmus Ira Gualtieri, a homeless elvish fencer and the leader of the last chosen heroes, had the Jade Crown flung into a bottomless toilet. It's been 2 months since the curse was broken, and there hasn't been much untold chaos to speak of. Disrupting the balance has turned the fencer into the most wanted criminal in the Empire, the so-called Mad Elf. Though his friends from the quest live in comfort and security, Ira himself has been on the run from the law. He has only his wits, his sword, and a magical disguise kit to keep him safe. Chapter 1. Ira Goes Home. Current roster. Ira, Fencer, level 65, HP 5,900, MP 680.
Hey-o, little dork, it's Dad. I'ma need you to come to the Imperial City as fast as you can and calm down your insane girlfriend. Some weird stuff happened and she's going ballistic. Look, call me back as soon as you get this, all right?
Ira sighed through his nose as the voicemail finished. And like that, my mid-morning nap is ruined. His eyes were already half-closed as he heard the message. The glare of the snow against the sun outside was too much. Rather, it would be if the sun hadn't suddenly decided to bugger off in the middle of his nap. The white woods outside the passenger car window became a pale blue haze. The click-clacking of the train wheels below were muffled by the whistling winds. Either I accidentally took the train to North Rosencrace, or that blizzard's coming in earlier than expected. A tinny voice on the intercom.
The next stop will be Nargili, Hayseed Stadium.
So the second option. Mira stretched his arms. Blood rushed to his head as he wedged himself from the blue fabric of his seat and stood up. Looking down, he saw pinstriped pants above two leather shoes, rather than his own jeans, left combat boot, and prosthetic right leg. He sighed with relief. Good. Still in disguise. Please tell me I haven't been eating up the battery while sleeping. Shroud's guy's battery level, 3%. Seriously? Another minute of napping and there'd be a SWAT team in here. Great job, kiddo. Focus, Ira. Dad'll probably want me to call him in my own voice. So, bathroom. Ira picked up his duffel bag and made his way down to the front of the car, where he could look forward to such wonderful treasures as a sliding metal door, a sink with a non-potable sign bigger than the faucet, last decade's soap, and a freezing hole to the tracks below.
Are you all right, sir?
he caught a concerned voice from a nearby aisle seat. Female, late 40s, probably named Linda.
"Oh, the limp?" said Ira. "I'm fine, missy. The old shrapnel's still in there from the war."
The fact that Ira was disguised as a 14-year-old boy in his church clothes didn't occur to him until 10 feet down the line. Once the sliding door was shut, he sat on top of the toilet's lid to muffle the roar of the tracks and wind. Ira, D-cloak. Twirling holographic mirrors and hexagons heralded the return of classic Ira. The green sweater, peg leg, long hair, scalvona and scabbard, bird-calling whistle, PTSD, self-loathing, overthinking, general mental instability, and that natural been-on-the-road-for-weeks young adult musk we've come to know and barely tolerate. With a bracing deep breath of the old musk, Ira called his father back.
"Little dork,"
said the gruff, damp voice on the other side.
"Where the hell are you?"
"Yo, meatbag," said Ira. "I'm on the way back from some Christmas shopping in Tarlin. What's going on with Liv?"
"Yeah, it's worse than I thought. Your girlfriend's officially gone ape-vog. Like she tore up my recliner and threw it off the bus."
Ira rubbed his forehead. "Okay, first off, she's not my girlfriend."
"Oh my gods! Fine. Platonic besties, bosom buddies, bosom explorers, friendly rivals, bodily fluid mixologists, I don't care. You know what she is to me? The non-consensual recliner disposal lady."
"Calm down, meatbag. Just tell me what happened."
"Okay, so there I was on the doom wagon, hanging out with the missus, talking about what we need for the room. We got to Tanya a new room recently. Like, I got another one of those portable dimensional gateways from the black market on Delgado Street. Had to trade him some depleted uranium and a little something-something in a plastic baggie. I'm not sure what it was. Drugs? Poison? Magic crystal stuff? I don't know. Point being, it was in one of those big freezer baggies and had a bunch of handwritten warning labels. I'm like 90% sure it changed hands with one of the Koscheis. Could have gotten 10 grand for it easily, but this gateway? It's just the sex, I tell you. It's like a little portable 2-star hotel room. 2.5 if you give it a little elbow grease. This thing was worth at least 500 grand. And the buyer's such a dumbass, all you have to do is throw in a couple.
Dad, I'm uncloaked in a train bathroom. I'm on borrowed time here."
"But it's got a vogging chandelier, little dork."
"Cut to the chase. Why's she mad?"
"All right. So, I'm on the couch teaching Titania how to crochet. Don't ask me how I know how to do that. It's a little something I do on the side. Not really much of a..."
"Dad!"
"Right, sorry. Liv comes running, like 100-meter dash kind of stuff, from down the turret stairs without her mask. She lost it this morning. That's when it all started."
Ira's eyes widened. "Wait, she lost her mask?"
"Apparently someone stole it. She goes all, 'Roar! I don't know where my mask is. It's been stolen. Where the vog is it?' And I go, 'Vog, if I know, I'd say check your face, but that seems to be out of the question.' She all, 'Mask, mask, mask, roar, kill, kill, kill.' And I go, 'Dude, quit overreacting. It's just a stupid mask. We can get you a new one.' That's when she straight up flips at me, calls me a useless drunk with no real friends. I mean, it's not like she's technically wrong, but come on! And then she grabs my recliner."
The fencer sighed, with his free hand against his forehead. "Okay, meatbag, I love you to death, but for the love of Argo, shut the vog up and listen. This makes the 17th time I've had to say this exact sentence to him."
"Yeah, all right."
"Look, how much do you know about mystics?"
"Okay, let's see, Misha, you got this. Mystics, mystics..."
10 seconds of dead air passed before Ira heard his father's voice again.
"I'm back, little dork. Mystics. Liv's one of them. Their eyes are literally on fire for some reason. Powerful wizards. Can create their own destruction and black magic spells. They like... masks with... Thaumokinetic...
Stop looking at Lumapedia and listen, said Ira.
I'm not!
The sound of computer keys fell silent on the other end. She probably destroyed your stupid chair because...
Okay, what the actual hell, little dork? It's not just a stupid chair, it's a...
Misha didn't often realize his mistakes, but when he did, Ira swore he could hear the sound of rusty iron gears in his brain awakening from their yearly slumber.
Oh, wasn't just a stupid mask either. Damn, kinda feel like a dick now.
Yeah, tradition has mystics never take it off. Not until they meet their true love. Then it's kind of an engagement ring. Unless it's stolen, which means they're a slave. So whoever took the mask has some seriously perverted intentions with her. Ira hoped that would be enough of an explanation, knowing well that it probably wasn't.
Please just hang up, Dad. I gotta focus on getting out of here and recharging my disguise kit. How long have I been in this bathroom? Are the other passengers getting suspicious?
Then what the vog are you still doing on the phone?
Yelled Misha.
Some jackass is trying to vog with your wife. Get your ass off that train, get down here, and defend her honor.
What is this, the Dark Ages?
She's not my wife either.
You got matching band tattoos, said Misha. I'm not blind.
Well, there goes any hope I had of avoiding a migraine today.
Yeah, well, I don't have her mask. Besides, Liv can more than hold her own. It's not her safety or defending her honor I'm worried about. It's what she'll do to the dumb bastard that took it once she finds him, and the kind of legal trouble it'll put her in. I'll be there soon.
Yeah. You save that princess. Later, Galahad.
Bonus points. Dad's drunk already. Misha hung up and Ira took in a deep breath.
It's barely noon, and I already feel like skinny dipping in a blender.
Oh, come on. I can't angst myself into a soggy little meat pretzel just yet. I've got plenty of good stuff to look forward to. Christmas is only 2 days away. And not only that, it's my first honest-to-God's Christmas with Dad in 5 years. This time I can celebrate it somewhere other than a train's cargo hold or a bus terminal. http://lumapedia.co.ari/Christmas/. Christmas. This article refers to the holiday. For the erotic tennis technique, please refer to Fiskian Blood Christmas. Creighton's Isthmus Day, often shortened to Christmas, is a holiday celebrated throughout the Aresian Empire on December 25th. According to the Church of Ares, the Isthmus of Creighton, located near the North Pole, is an annual meeting place for the three gods, Argo, Raphith, and Galgalim. They gather at the Isthmus on the night of December 24th to decide whether or not humankind deserves to live for another year. The discussion is mediated by Lord Santa, the fearsome man-eating frost giant of ancient Pohjolan sagas. If the gods deem humanity worthy, the sun rises again on December 25th. As per the terms of the gods' long-standing blood pact with Lord Santa, the evil frost giant leaves random celebratory gifts for mankind, regardless of whether or not the gifts are welcome. On the other hand, if humanity deserves to be destroyed, the gods grant Santa permission to remove the indestructible lock and chains placed on his trousers. Common Christmas traditions include, but are not limited to, ornamental appeasement trees, an exchange of gifts, caroling, beard decorating, Dungation and Church of Raphith, Channel 4's broadcast of Vinnie Vulture's 24-hour G-Willicky-Woo-Crazy-Charismas-Jamboree, Celsiorin, and Apologizing Profusely, Rosencration and Northwestern Orthodox.
Did I mention?
Ira forgot to lock the sliding door to the bathroom.
Sir?
With that one syllable,
all thoughts of Christmas were lost into the blizzard outside. The conductor, along with that "Are you all right, sir?" lady from earlier, stood in the doorway staring at him. Ira checked if his shrouds guys was active. It wasn't. "Hi," said Ira. "Are you all right?" asked the conductor. Fog. Better play it cool for now. They probably don't recognize me. Yeah, said Ira. Sorry for being in here for so long. Just having a mental breakdown. Oh, have you tried yoga? Was in the middle of it, said Ira. Frozen anus pose. Keeps my lower chakras from getting too spicy. Namaste, said the conductor, who had 0.3% of an idea what that word meant. The Linda, which is totally her name, rapidly shifted her gaze between her smartphone's screen and Ira's face, over and over again as if to make sure. She knows. Gotta bail. Now. The intercom.
Now approaching. Nargili. Hayseed Stadium.
And there's my stop, said Ira, edging through the two-person blockade at the bathroom door. All that football ain't gonna see itself.
You mean at Hayseed? Sir, the Nargaliers are in Latosa today, playing the Gremlins.
Ira scoffed as he backed away toward the exit vestibule. He whipped out a crumpled sundries receipt from his pocket. Pretending it was a ticket, he looked it over. Yep. Still unironically spent 50G on pickles. Huh! Then I gotta go find the bastard who gave me this phony playoffs ticket, corner him in a dark alley, and chisel him a few extra nostrils. Either way, this day ain't going to waste. He elbowed the automatic door panel behind him, and with a final, "Thanks for the clarification," Ira was out of range of the conductor's bewildered stare. The door windows outside became less and less of a white blur as the train slowed down. Through the whistling winds, Ira could see the beauty of Nargili's famous fir trees between their equally famous dive bars and crumbling public infrastructure. Maybe I could grab a bite to eat once the Shroud's guys charges back up. Wonder what's going on in Nargili this time of year. The answer to his question lay in a ceiling ad just above him. Praise the Laud. 53rd Annual Nargili Policeman's Union Prayer Breakfast, featuring Reverend Cartwright, sponsored by Koscheis Deli Meats and the Aresian Knights Templar, 9 a.m. to 12 p.m., December 23rd, Hayseed Stadium, Nargili. Remembering the current date and time, Ira clenched his teeth. If the gods are trying to send me a message, this is harassment and I'll sue. The intercom.
Ding dong. Nargili. Hayseed Stadium.
The door opened to at least 100 blue uniforms, crowned by mortified stares in Ira's direction. Ira closed his eyes, pursed his lips, and filled his lungs with December winds and the sour metallic odors of the train's wheels and undercarriage. Ira. Blade recall. A snap of his fingers and his sword, the basket-hilted Schiavona that had kept him breathing through worse, flew from his scabbard and nuzzled into his right fist. 45-degree upward lunge, flip it around back, bolt for cover, improvise from there. Let's do this. Ira, flee. Ira visualized the sword in his hand as an iron cable dangling from a jet plane's tail during takeoff. The telekinesis took care of the rest, and Ira was hanging from his flying sword 10 feet above the screaming crowd. He heard the pop-pop-pops of concealed pistols as he flew toward the other side of the train. Lieutenant Colonel Peterson, attack. A bullet grazed the side of Ira's head. His face flashed white with war pixels. 603 damage to Ira. Disoriented, Ira tumbled down into a distant snowbank in the middle of Moray Avenue, Nargili's busiest six-lane thoroughfare. You'd think the city would have plowed this by now. Oh well, more things to hide in. The sound of steel grating against asphalt could no longer be ignored. Snowplow guy, Sorry, I'm late. A giant speeding slab of painted yellow steel rolled Ira into its collective burrito of asphalt-flavored snow cone. The low visibility meant Ira didn't have so much as half a honk in warning for such savage bulldozery. 1,206 damage to Ira. But the pain and HP loss weren't anything new to Ira. Though half of his body was ablaze with white pixels, he sighed in relief, knowing that the snowblind cops would lose sight of him for a good 12 seconds. Got away safely. lumapedia.co.ari/war-molecule/. War molecule. Redirected from war pixels. This article refers to the particle. For the outdated ethnic slur, see anti-dwarvenism. War molecules are a naturally occurring phenomenon caused by taking damage during combat mode. In layman's terms, when someone is hurt while holding a weapon or assuming a combat stance. White, rectangular pixels of light cover the affected portion of the body. This phenomenon is poorly understood by modern science, and its cause remains the subject of heated debate. The most commonly accepted theory is the rated T for teen hypothesis, that it stems from the gods' desire to censor combat-based blood and gore for some assumed audience of impressionable youngsters. Among atheists, the most common explanation is, because, of course. Ira Gualtieri, the Mad Elf, the most wanted man in the Empire, was loose in Nargeele. SWAT teams had rolled into town, blizzard be damned. Every major intersection had an armored van and heavy gunners. Official police wizards were summoned, with their robes and wands long since abandoned for necromantic riot gear and enchanted stun batons. Their bulletproof witch hats looked especially silly, provided you were the sort of top brass who didn't need to worry about being turned into a hamster. Even a detachment of Templars were scrambled to the area. Martial law was in place for the whole afternoon. Every public venue was closed, every TV station was interrupted with weather and manhunt updates, and every school was on lockdown. Every school, that is, except for Lupescu College Prep. Its windows that weren't dark were boarded up. The marquee outside read, "Closed due to vampire infestation, minus the vowels." A pile of half-eaten plastic vowels at the bottom were covered in week-old saliva. If you force a vampire to eat letters of the alphabet, it'll always go for the vowels or word blood. Ira trudged in a slithering line through the 5-foot-deep snow of the courtyard. His teeth chattered. The effects of the shoplifted warming enchantment rings in his pockets were dwindling. The ancient and terrifying magical art of actually wearing a goddamn jacket was still something that mystified Ira. Once he reached the front doors of the abandoned school, he wiped the frost from the door windows with his sleeve. He caught a glimpse of a blinking red light within from a desk phone. This place still has power. I can charge my disguise kit here. But it would be wrong to break into this place. Really insensitive. Ira, break and enter. With a flick of Ira's wrist, the Schiavona shot through a door window. Ira shoved an arm through the hole and opened the door from the inside. Really wrong. Ira, blade recall. One snap of his fingers and the sword flew back into its scabbard. Once he was inside, Ira made a beeline for the security desk. The place was pitch black, save for a dull blue glow from a few foggy windows. A stream of thick dust danced through the beams. Ira sat down at the desk, pawing around in the dark for an outlet for the Shroud's guys. My kingdom for the location of the nearest outlet, or at least a flashlight. I can't stay here for long. I left a visible trail in the snow outside. Anyway, where are the Upir, ambush. Ah! A sickening man-thing fell from the ceiling. 5.5 feet tall, pink flesh with wispy hairs. A hybrid of a naked mole rat and a monkey. Bestiary.
Upir. Type, undead. Weaknesses, fire, holy. HP, 2000. Description. Objectively speaking, the Upir is the least pleasant type of vampire in existence. Upir are to vampires what roadkill is to a well-kept hunting trophy. Most aren't capable of speech, and the ones that are speak only hack-ack, which is in itself a crude creole of the more sophisticated monster languages of grack-ack-ack and gurgle. Their bodies are naked, rotting, and devoid of any genitalia, as if to offend both prudes and perverts at the same time. The vampire clung to Ira's chest, with its fangs half an inch deep in his neck. Searing pain that caught him out of combat mode aside, Ira could only think about the creature's stench. Candy corn? Why candy corn? Focus. I'm not even in combat mode, so blood loss is a real concern. Wait a minute. Hey, big guy, said Ira. The Upir gurgled a response as it felt for a good vein. Yeah, I'm gonna level with you. I've got chronic necrylic poisoning. You're really not gonna like my blood. Gah! It scoffed, which we're going to go ahead and assume means, shut up and donate that plasma into my face, you meat. But as Ira felt the cold sting of the Upir's slimy tongue, he was proven right. The beast fell off him, gagging and whining on the floor. It clawed at its own tongue, desperate to pry off every trace of Ira's blood. Told you, man, said Ira. I am not food grade. The vampire pointed at Ira, slinging all sorts of verbal abuse about the quality of his blood. To the monster's credit, if Ira could speak hack-hack, he'd have been absolutely livid. Okay. Look, here's how it happened. He lifted up the right leg of his pants, revealing the top of his prosthesis and a lump of toxic gray plastic at the stump of his knee, having long since fused with his flesh. 5 years ago, fall of Rosencrace. You probably don't know what that is, do you? The vampire flipped him off and skittered away down the hallway, only to return, backing away and gack-acking to a rushing cascade of flesh on linoleum. Presumably it was a warning to the Upir's brothers about Ira's hideous-tasting blood. This would have been useful if the Upir had any sense of restraint in front of potential food. Ira sprung from the desk. Oh good, the rest are here. How many Upir are we talking about? Upir 2 through 87. Charge! Nope. Ira. Nope. Ira flipped the desk over onto the coming undead meat wave. It landed with a splash of white pixels. 1,205 damage to Upir 5 through 16. It was an insignificant blow to the swarm, but the flash of the war pixels illuminated the hallway for a brief moment, just enough time for Ira to see the doors to the gymnasium. He drew the sword, imagined the hilt as a cable connected to a speeding boat, and proceeded to invisibly water ski down the hall and barge through the doors. They weren't locked. Good for his entry, bad for his safe exit. He felt for a locking mechanism in the darkness. None. Seriously? As a last resort, Ira slid against the middle of the double doors, using his already aching butt as a doorstop. And not a moment too soon, for the Upir landed on the doors with a collective schlump, forming a wall of rotten flesh that bore down against the creaking doors. Damn it. Reckon I'm a few seconds from a messy death as soon as they break through. Okay, serious mode. Problem. Basically a swimming pool's worth of hungry vampires. Facts. I've got an open wound on my neck. Nothing too deep, but could be problematic if it gets infected. I can worry about that after I escape. My blood tastes terrible to Upir, which they can only find out by biting me one by one. I give it about 7 more chomp-lick-no-thanks fiascos before I bleed out. Fighting them would be impractical at best, would make me into an elf smoothie at worst. I can take down a few without a scratch, but not this many at once.
Okay, what do vampires hate? Mirrors? Nah, Upir are blind. They only use scent and hearing to find prey. Holy stuff. Sign of Argo's horns, Eye of Galgalim, maybe a prayer or two. Nah, my relationship with Galgalim is kinda complicated. Oh, I know the name of the voice high most, the god over gods. I'm the only living person other than Titania who knows that name. Maybe I could say it really loud and with enough grandiose gesturing, and they'll all dissolve at once. Yeah, and if they survive, then a couple bazillion Upir will know that the one true god is a terrified intern named Angel Sanchez. Result, planet-wide existential blue screen of death. That name's secret for a reason. Too risky. No holy name-dropping. Damn it, running on empty here. Garlic? Not even I'm weird enough to carry around garlic in my pockets on demand. Stake to the hearts? Yeah, one by one? Not gonna happen. Running water? You're in the gym, not the bathroom. Sunlight? There's a vogging blizzard outside, numbnuts. Total cloud cover. A blizzard is technically lots of running water. No, it's not. Salt? You're thinking of demons. Salt repels vampires but can't kill them. Still, that could buy me some time. Does this look like the cafeteria? Salty food? This is getting stupid. Maybe I should just accept my death. Aggressively denying it like this would make me just like Gregor Koschei. But I'm not done. Yes. Yes, you are. Says who? Says... I unironically spent 50 G on pickles at Sundry's. They're still in my duffel bag. New plan. 1. Pour the jar of pickles on myself. Get salty. Bonus, there's some pickled garlic in there, too. 2. Vampires think I smell like churches, exorcisms, and it burns and avoid me. 3. Charge my disguise kit undisturbed. Era. Self-garnish. Era had never been more thrilled to open a plastic tub of pickles. This was probably a lie. He's got a weakness for bread and butter chips. After subjecting himself to a caustic shower of brine and Dungation fire spicy wedges, well, there was the small matter of the open wound on his neck, and spicy pickle juice was the last thing that would have felt nice on it. Era screamed through his teeth, spitting out every profanity he could think of over a 10-second span, with a grand total of 27. He had to make up a few, though. Schmorger is the most promising newcomer by far. Era's pain tolerance was still as ironclad as it ever was, but he was more frustrated at his lack of hindsight. Nothing is so painful as one's own stupidity. Still, the plan worked, and the Upir outside hissed as they recoiled to the other side of the hallway. Era, the blood of whom was 200% less suckworthy to even the least discerning of vampires, opened the doors with a smug grin. Before realizing he and the vampires were stuck here until his gadgets recharged. Well, this is awkward. Okay, new plan. 2 hours later, the Shrouds guys and Era's phone were charging at an outlet in what was once Miss Frobisher's classroom for algebra, geometry, and totally no secret trysts with the lunch lady. Era, meanwhile, sat on top of the desk. The Upir lounged about the darkness, eager to hear the next parts of his two-hour-long yarn. "So this jackass straight up gives me the jade crown," he said. "Puts it right on my head, thinks I don't know how to use it. So I summon a daggerfly, and next thing you know, he's clutching his balls and sobbing. Literally sobbing." The vampires clawed at their own faces as they wheezed and cackled. Unknown. Dramatic entrance. Dust and drywall, broken glass, and a rush of icy wind and snow burst in from outside. Era closed his eyes, disappointed that he couldn't finish the story. Only harmless things could startle him anymore. When he opened his eyes, the upir had all vanished with the wind. Huh, guess the snow does count as running water. Poor fellas, they were good listeners. And a 12-foot-tall, 12-foot-wide suit of golden power armor. A Templar. And a high-ranking one, too. Probably followed the trail I left in the snow. Stood in a gaping hole that used to be several windows. A male voice emanated from a speaker on the side of the helmet, barely audible from the static and tactical voice deepeners.
Erasmus Gualtieri, in the name of the Holy Knights Templar of Ares, I am placing you under arrest. If you choose not to comply with...
Yeah, cool, said Ira. Look, it's only a few days from Christmas. You should be at home with your family. So just put down your weapons and we can both pretend this never happened, right? Ira looked at the Templar's robotic gloves, both of which were unarmed. Or put down your lack of weapons. I don't know. It's been a day. Inquisitor Stagley, summon weapons. The Templar extended his hands and in a flash, the edges of said flash read, thank you for using Jones Telelogistics Solutions, a pair of electrified scimitars sat in each metallic fist.
Yeah, very funny. Once I take you out and claim your bounty, every day is gonna be Christmas morning at the Stagley place.
Ira grimaced and drew his sword. Ugh, seriously? Boss battle. Inquisitor Stagley. Naughty list veteran since 48. Bestiary. Inquisitor Stagley. Type, human, Templar. Weakness is black magic. HP, 500. Power armor HP, 400,000. Description. Usually, power armor is reserved for older Templars who are no longer in fighting condition, being that their usage requires all four of the pilot's limbs to be amputated and replaced with plugs. Officer Stagley, at 73 years old, is no exception. Ira yanked the disguise kit and the phone from their charging cables and doubled back into the hallway. Inquisitor Stagley, discharge. A wave of electromagnetic force shot from the Templar's right sword. Arcs of blue and gold flickered through the open door, bringing light back to the dark corridor for a fraction of a second. Missed. Though the attack missed, the sound was enough to startle Ira and make him trip into a glass display case of academic decathlon trophies. Tripped. 403 damage to Ira. More war pixels. Ira winced as he stood back up, using his unsheathed sword as a cane. This was probably poor blade discipline, and a true son of Mount Calibri Academy ought to have known better than to risk dulling the edge of his Schiavona. But come on, go easy on him, it's Christmas. Dropping the sword in combat mode now would have meant civilian broken glass injuries and all the blood loss and tetanus shots that come with it. Halfway back up, Ira noticed that the Nargili County Dark Lord History 4th Place Cup was particularly sturdy and heavy. Damn, are they making these out of actual orichalcum? 4th place is looking vogging sweet all of a sudden. This and the sound of the Templar kicking a new Templar-sized doorway in the wall for himself gave Ira another disgusting little idea. Mark this one up as Thing I'm Going to Hell For number 4052. Ira, pick up your damn toys. Ira took the seven sturdiest-looking trophies and hurled them one by one in front of the crumbling hole in the wall. Once Stagley was in the hallway, a geography award under his boot sent him careening toward the linoleum. Tripped. 27 damage to Inquisitor Stagley. 603 damage to his power armor. Lost. Thunder Cleaver B. As Stagley fell, the sword in his right hand flew forward out of his grasp, in front of Ira. Ira snickered. Mount Calibri playbook maneuver Charlie Alpha Charlie Kilo, execute. Go hummingbirds. Ira, steel weapon. Now this, said Ira, throwing his Schiavona to the side, Don't get jealous, Schiavona. It's a trick. You're still my forever girl.
This is a sword!
He grabbed the power armor grade Thunder Scimitar with both hands.
Acquired Thunder Cleaver B.
Alert. You lack the minimum strength value to use this weapon properly.
Gee, you think?
Ira's knees buckled as he lifted the giant scimitar a whopping half foot off the floor.
That sword is Templar property,
said Stagley, standing back up. Really? Asked Ira, still straining to keep the sword in his hands. Then it'll make for an even better stocking stuffer back home.
Drop it! Now!
And what, pray tell, would I gain from that? There's enough charges against me already to have me launched into the sun. I doubt another grand larceny is going to make it any worse.
Give it back, or I'll kill you!
Are you implying that's not the reason you're here in the first place? Stagley paused for a moment, looking off to the side from behind his helmet, and responded.
I mean, you do have a point, but...
He sought for a way to finish the sentence, and finding nothing, groaned in frustration. Should we start over? Ira asked.
Can we please?
Cool. From the top, then. Ira cleared his throat into his shoulder, still holding the thunder sword. And action! You'll never take me alive, Templar bastard! Inquisitor Stagley, charge!
Then die!
The Templar sprinted toward Ira. Once he was only a few feet away, Ira, I said, pick up your damn toys! Stagley neglected to notice the Schiavona floating at his ankle. Tripped. The tip of Ira's stolen scimitar was waiting to catch the Templar's fall. Ira, trap strike. 492 damage to Inquisitor Stagley. 12,059 damage to power armor. Inquisitor Stagley was mortally wounded. Stagley screamed as he fell, thoroughly kebabbed on his own sword. Semi-transparent war pixels began to float from within his armor. Pixel fading. A prelude to death in combat. Perhaps it was the season and its associated tree decorating nonsense, but Ira felt a little more remorse about this particular killing than some of the others he'd been a part of lately. He knelt down to the prone Templar. Sorry about this, said Ira. You know, I don't like killing people even when I have to. It's always my last choice. I've got a healing potion in my bag if you need it. I mean, it won't remove the sword, but it'll keep you in one piece until you get to safety. Though the Templar initially tried to ignore Ira, he said,
So, the mad elf's just a scared little kid after all.
I mean, as much as I want to be offended, you're not exactly wrong. Sure you don't want a potion? Stagley chuckled through his last breaths.
Nah, it's fine. This armor's a walking coffin anyway. And hey, Merry Christmas.
You too. A plume of pixels escaped from the cracks in Stagley's power armor, and like that, the armor was empty. Victory! Gained 15,033 experience and 14,000 gold. Sweet. More Christmas shopping money. Just enough G to get that 12-year-old vintage ethanol Dad was raving about. Though part of me is still convinced that it's not even a thing. If it isn't, I'll just grab him some whiskey and finish up the rest of my Christmas shopping. Let's see. Already finished with Liv, Titania, Noah, and Gina, just in case. I should probably snag an Orthodox Saint's relic for Ophelia. A new mandolin for Steve, and a cooler full of rat carcasses for Branwyn. Ira jumped as the empty suit of power armor began to talk.
Stagley, come in!
It was the dead Templar's communicator, mumbling within the helmet.
Your suit's biosigns went dead. Could be another sensor malfunction, but just thought we'd check.
Well, crap. New plan. Ira pawed for a release button on the helmet, finding nothing.
Stagley! Stagley, come in!
a weak hinge. Era kicked it, and a hatch unbuckled.
Stay right there, all right? You're gonna be fine. We're sending evac.
From a few floors below, Era could hear shattering glass, stomping power armor feet, and distorted voices calling out for the dead Inquisitor. Fan-voggin-tastic. Okay, let's see here. Option one, fight, realize I'm outnumbered, end up on the business end of a rocket launcher, blammo. It's snowing Era flakes across the Tri-County area. Option two, hide and or run, realize they've got object-penetrating radar, leave in cuffs, plea bargain. Best-case scenario, spend the rest of my life in solitary confinement. Oh no, two unpleasant choices. My one weakness. Era glanced over the interior of the collar. He pried open a small black plastic panel and saw a series of directional buttons. A label. Suit taxi. Logistics use only. He grinned. Whatever shall I do? I'm screwed either way. Era. Third path.
There's a thought experiment I've heard over and over among my colleagues at the university ad nauseam, and I'm frightfully tired of it. I will relate it to you thus. A runaway trolley is speeding down the track, approaching a split path. You stand at the lever controlling which direction the trolley will take. Five men are tied to the left track, and one two-year-old girl is tied to the other. All you have time to do is pull the lever one way or another. Knowing this, what is the most ethical course of action to take? Make the trolley go left or right? Professor Lorenzini, a utilitarian, tells you, kill the girl, less people will die. Dr. Haftor, an idealist, tells you, kill the five men. The girl is too young to have done anything deserving of her fate. I tell them, much to their annoyance, the answer is to not kill anyone. You'd jam the lever halfway, derail the trolley, and make six new friends. Lorenzini and Haftor scoff in disgust. They tell me I'm being irrational, that I'm operating outside of the parameters of the question. They make up all sorts of silly new rules, such as the lever can only be pulled one way or the other, there are people on the trolley, and the trolley is going too fast to derail harmlessly. So I tell them, then the real answer has nothing to do with the trolley at all, because this is clearly the work of an evil sadist who ought to be locked up before he stages more trolley-themed carnage. You ought to deal with him before you shift any blame to the poor sod at the lever. Lorenzini and Haftor tell me I'm being ridiculous and avoiding the question. Therefore, I promptly kill them, on the grounds that I made them up a few minutes ago. Ergo, no moral deficit, and I can please both of their stupid schools of thought. Imaginary as they were, I do hate those two professors with a passion, and I formed the third path method of thinking entirely to spite them, that so long as you keep looking, you need never to choose between two unpleasant options. As I write this, I can just hear them whining in horror from my words as they listen from the depths of hell. On a related note, I may be going mad. Might as well. Always wanted to give it a shot.
Lutero Gualtieri, Collected Essays, Volume 6. A handful of the Templars' armored personnel carriers sat in the courtyard. On the roof of one of the carriers stood an impatient lieutenant who scanned the building with his binoculars for any sign of the mad elf. An explosion at the southern wall of the building broke the lieutenant's concentration. Inquisitor Stagley's power armor had busted through. It floated 50 feet in the air from the gravity runes in his boots, T-posing. One of the thunder swords was missing. The other was impaled through his chest. The lieutenant dropped the binoculars and fumbled through his coat. Yeah, not all Templars have power armor, chill, for his communicator.
Stagley, come in!
Era, Shroud's guys.
cloaked as white_old_man_voice_28.shrd. Sound only.
All right, all right. Loud and clear,
said a Stagley-esque tone on the other end of the line.
Don't have to shout. So here's the thing. The mad elf got away. Reckon he went to the sewers through the boiler room. Sorry, fellas.
Never mind that. You're badly wounded. You need to come down for first aid and power suit maintenance.
That's okay. I'll just walk it off.
With respect, sir. You've been impaled by your own sword.
Just a flesh wound.
Negative, sir. That is a mortal wound.
We'll agree to disagree. Question, though.
Yes, sir.
Remind me, what's the penalty for desertion in my rank?
The lieutenant gave an exasperated look to a power-suited knight on the ground, who shrugged.
You're the highest-ranking officer here, sir, so I don't believe we'd have the clearance to take any puni-
Era. Flee.
Kay, thanks! Bye!
The power suit shot southward in the air, upwards of 60 miles an hour, swirling and twirling, until three-dimensional space began to run out of ideas for ways to fail at piloting the damn thing. Which gives rise to the question, perhaps a rhetorical one, what kind of experience was Ira Gualtieri having at the moment? For starters, he was hunched over in a semi-fetal position in the top half of the power armor's chassis, which was only big enough for a human torso. Ira wasn't a tall elf, and right now this was the only thing keeping his escape plan in working order. His sword was splinted against his back. His duffel bag was thoroughly besquished in the lower half. Much to Ira's chagrin, he had to jettison the rest of the pickle jars before making his escape. A searing pain between Ira's legs reminded him, at all times, that the blade of an electrified scimitar was nestled against the Gualtieri family jewels. His left foot was planted against the suit's crotch area. There sat a cybernetic chamber pot for the late Mr. Stagley, the absence of whom left the fetid tanks open to the air within. Ira prayed that his makeshift boot seal was airtight. The prayers were only half answered. His right foot, well, that was missing, and that's a whole other set of tragedies altogether. His right hand was nestled under the helmet, desperately juggling his fingers between the move the suit for storage buttons for a way to slow the suit down, or at least put a stop to its, look, Ira, this is my impression of a gyroscope nonsense. His left hand was propped for safety between his forehead and a sharp cluster of wires to his side for a makeshift pillow, albeit filled with aching carpal bones. His phone dangled from his left hand for navigation, with the GPS map, summoned on the touchscreen with Ira's tongue, which absorbed a few splashing droplets of the recently deceased's final bathroom break, Galgalim bless Ira's poor soul, the only guiding light home. In short, Ira's ride was subpar, and only recommended for a niche audience of adventurers. All of this, of course, was before the power armor crashed through the ice of the River Galga a few streets over. It was 6 o'clock in the evening, and Misha Gualtieri was stressed. The one-eyed, one-armed elf sat in a patio chair on the sidewalk outside the doom wagon, sucking a cheap cigar. No snow, but the wind chill insisted otherwise. Still, he didn't bother with a jacket, and often bragged that his beer gut contained enough insulation for a trek through the frozen wastes of Poyola. The doom wagon had been idling in Imp Cities. If you think every poor sumbitch in Ares has the stamina to refer to the Imperial City with all seven syllables every time, I've got some bad news. Ritzy Riverview Quarter for the whole afternoon. Electric lamps, rearranged to give the illusion of black wrought iron oil lamps that required a booming lamplighter market to exist, dotted the edges of the riverwalk. Yuppies walking their puppies gave Misha the side eye, holding the leashes of their purebred labradoodles a little tighter. Misha chuckled at the sight. So long as no one had the balls to call the police or tell him how much he needed to go back to Rosie Crace, he wouldn't have to become a murderer again. As he looked out to the river Galga, what troubled Misha was his son's absence. Ira always made certain to keep his rendezvous pointing punctual. Any delays carried the non-zero chance of his capture by the authorities. He sighed.
All my life, I wanted Ira to be a badass, he said to himself. Turns out I forgot to account for all the anxiety it would give me. What I wouldn't give for my boy to be a basement-dwelling sociopath.
Suddenly, schlup, 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 came the flopping, soggy footsteps of an old lady, shivering, dressed in layers upon layers of wet trench coats and blankets. She limped toward Misha, her mouth open in pain, revealing all 3½ teeth. Misha raised an eyebrow, grinning, but shook his head and pointed to the doom wagon.
Sorry, gorgeous. The Misha man's taken.
Misha was a man of interesting tastes. The lady's lip trembled, trying to form words.
Ah, come on, baby, said Misha. Don't be like that. I'm sure you'll find someone just as unthinkably handsome as...
Ira, super secret password.
Have you ever heard,
she said finally,
of the beast of Mount Calibri?
Misha's heart jumped, and the rest of him followed suit.
Little dork! Vog me, what happened? You got hypothermia or summit?
Probably. Long story. Basically.
Shut up and get on the bus. Let me help you.
One dropped shrouds, guys, one change of clothes, one cleaning spell, two healing spells, three space heaters, four painkillers, one phone dehydrating rice bath, two cups of piping hot chamomile tea with maple syrup and brown sugar, an elvish thing, don't judge, and 12 throw blankets later, Ira's body was back into something resembling working order. So he gave a lengthy explanation of his escape to Misha and Titania. The latter sat draped across the new recliner. More on that in a moment. She sipped a wine glass full of Yalthrek, while Misha sat on the floor and whispered poetry to her toes, as was the kobold custom. Yalthrek, old evening cocktail from Kobolheim. 2 parts grain alcohol, 1 part horse's blood. Remainder of recipe withheld from curious listeners. You are not a kobold, and you will literally die.
You are an absolute masochist, my boy, said Titania.
Ira chuckled. That's one way of putting it. How about you guys? I see you replaced the recliner, so is Liv okay?
Oh, that's my department, said Misha.
He pointed to Titania's feet and called off to the side,
Steve, can you take over?
A familiar Capuchin monkey skeleton clambered over the edge of the new recliner, a mandolin in his hand, and began moving his mouth up and down to her feet. As an undead familiar with no vocal folds, Steve couldn't speak. But Titania knew there was a lot of de facto monkey poetry implied and appreciated it regardless. Misha sat next to Ira on the couch.
So, Liv's fine, he said. Right after I called you, she came in and apologized. Said she found her mask. Gave me a bunch of G to get a new recliner. Seemed really happy about something, but wouldn't specify.
Right after you called me, huh? Said Ira. The universe's timing is once again fantastically cruel to old Ira. Well, she's happy now, so that's good. Cool that you could get a new recliner on such short notice.
Thanks. I shoplifted it.
For a brief moment, Ira tried to believe that this was the stupidest thing he'd heard his father confess to. That would have been merciful, at least.
She left a note for you, said Titania. It seems there's something she would rather tell you than us.
She handed Ira an index card-sized envelope. It read, 4/ on the side in old-fashioned lettering. Liv impulse bought a bargain calligraphy set from the bookstore the other day and had been downright obsessed. Ira grabbed the envelope and was about to open it when he heard Misha whispering in his ear,
"Looks like she's taken the next step. So, if you need any advice for, you know, thing is, I've been around lots of ladies. You need a teacher. You want a keeper, right? There's like 5 areas of a woman's body you gotta remember, and they're not what you think."
"Steve, shut up, chump." Misha yelped as Steve's teeth sank into his ankle. "Thank you, Steve," said Ira. He opened the envelope.
"From the desk of Mystic Liv. Sorceress, chosen hero, douchebag exterminator. Yo, Slasher. Would have texted you this, but I used up my data plan looking up autopsy videos. Sad trombone. Get this. I was on watch duty in the crow's nest when I dozed off and some jackass took my mask. I might have flipped out at your dad a little. My bad. But guess who gave me a call not even 5 minutes later? Mr. Sam. My old probation officer, remember? He caught the thief, beat the vog out of him, and got my mask back. And now he wants to hang out with me and catch up. Christmas miracle, bitches! I'm so excited I could puke. Probably will. Did. Hope the stain isn't too noticeable. Can't wait to tell him all about you especially. He'd love to meet you sometime. Headed to his place now. Back later tonight. Love you."
Critical hit. Ira bowed his head to hide his blush from the others and muffle his hyperventilation.
"Well, okay, she actually used the L word. Not a drill. This is happening. Casual. Yes, it's a thing you can say casually to a friend. There wasn't an I in front of it, so no hopes up getting. No overstepping of the boundaries. Realism, yes, good. Now, where was..."
"She is in danger," said Titania. All eyes in the bus turned to Titania. She had a tight look to her face, the kind of gut feeling only an ancient Kobol queen could have before her army charged into a losing battle.
"Is this one of your magical premonitions?" asked Ira. "Or just a gut feeling?"
Titania slowly turned to Ira.
"Yes."
Chapter 2. Unmasked. RK.
"Of course, we shouldn't depose my father. What good would that do? Yes, he is a dangerous idiot. No, he can't be reasoned with. The real issue here is that only violence can remove him, and that would result in someone even more dangerous, say, the mad elf, becoming his replacement. If a problem can't be solved peacefully, then we ought to stop calling it a problem."
GA.
"And we agree wholeheartedly. However, the question was about that mystery girl you said you were going to marry this Christmas."
"I'm aware. I've decided to answer the questions you should ask instead."
"Interesting choice. What made you decide to do this?"
"Yes, the fall of Rosencrace did happen. No, it wasn't as pants-wettingly cruel as the radicals in Excel make it out to be."
"Cool. Now, could we please return to the matter at hand?"
"Here's what little I can tell the public. We have several leads on his whereabouts and expect to have him apprehended by New Year's Eve. In the name of Ilya the Wise, I will find the mad elf, I will rehabilitate him, and we will be the best of friends."
What is 2 plus 2?
"Progress."
Gordy Albrecht, senior reporter of the Arcturus Review, 13th interview with Prince Raphael Koschei, excerpt. Liv, Mystic, level 73, HP 5430, MP 1400. The Hurley Avenue Christmas market was something Liv would have avoided at all costs. There were the 2-bit Santa impersonators that didn't have Santa's trademark chastity belt because the children. There were the whiter-than-Christmas carol singers, half of whom were probably named Carol and were physically incapable of not bringing up how perfect their name was for their profession. There was the fact that the festival's nagging, all-capsed ground rules were posted on big metallic signs on every other peppermint-painted lamppost. All the constant reminders of the bureaucracy and commercialization injected into a holiday originally meant for humanity to kick back and stretch their arms. It was insufferable. And worst of all were the goddamn specialty ornament booths. Thin, blown-glass, symmetrical thingamabobs shipped over from Scorpistan or some other country full of boiled turnips, log churches, and perpetually terrified children. The shapes were meaningless pattern things. Not that there was any real abstract art involved, but perhaps their creators thought an image of a jolly Christmas reindeer would have been too sexually provocative. The smallest of these ornaments cost upwards of 30 G. For all of 8 Christmases, Liv's Aunt Phoebe would buy 12 of the damn things in the 100 G range. When they ended up on the floor, without fail from being looked at too hard, Phoebe would go into fits, shriek sobbing with every breath. Fork over too much money, expect it to last, it breaks, scream, repeat. These ornaments were everything that was wrong with the world, deconstructed to its tantalizingly fragile source. Liv would have loved nothing more than to smash every last one, sweep up the shards, and melt them in a big iron pot until she could pour it into a mold for something useful. Point being, under normal circumstances, Liv would have given anything to stay home from the 1400 block of North Hurley during this sickeningly festive period of forced merriment. Mr. Sam, her old probation officer, mentor, and confidant, lived in a ritzy condo on the 17th floor of 1402 North Hurley, the entrance of which was just behind the caroler's bandstand. Until he called that afternoon, she had assumed he forgot about her completely. For this reason, and only this, Liv could force herself to weave through the giggling hordes of tourists. The faux wood apartment door of Unit 1702 slung open, and there he stood, his pink polo shirt unchangingly clean, his indoor sunglasses perpetually on, his black hair eternally coiffed, and his half-elvish ears as kinda sorta round as ever. His age was always an enigma. After years of no contact, the effects of his aging made even less sense to Liv. He could have been under 35 or over 50. Nothing in between.
"Fancy seeing you here, Starlight," said Mr. Sam.
His arms were stretched out wide in anticipation. Liv tackled him with a hug that nearly keeled him over.
"Whoa, careful there. Guy's gotta breathe. You been working out?"
No response. Liv kept clinging.
"You okay?" he asked.
Tears.
"I missed the vog out of you," said Liv.
He grinned.
"We seem to have that in common, Starlight."
2 hours with him passed like minutes. A plate glass, wall-sized window left nothing of the Imperial City skyline to their imagination. They sat next to the window at a small dining room table. 5 empty mugs of Liv's favorite latte sat by her side. Her mask, as promised, sat on the edge of the couch. But Mr. Sam insisted that she should only take it back once she left, and to remain unmasked until then. It was apparently part of some ancient mystic hospitality tradition he neglected to tell her about. When she pressed him for details about the tradition, he changed the subject to her savage beatdown of Lord Monty. Finally, once she'd reached the end of the lengthy account of her adventures with Slasher, Minion, Feely, Branny, Mish, Titania, "I've got to think of a stupid nickname for her. The monsters, the enemies, and every jackass and badass in between," Liv said, "now your turn."
"Hmm?" asked Mr. Sam.
"I just basically told you my life story," said Liv. "It's only fair that you tell me yours. I mean, why'd you stick your neck out for a girl like me? You went from knowing nothing about me to bailing me out of prison for killing a guy. All you knew was that I was 10 and a murderer."
"Oh, come on, Starlight. You know you're so much more than..."
"And not only that, but you turned my life around. You gave me my mask, you introduced me to everything I'm interested in. Hell, I even use your stupid nicknames for people.
She sighed.
Sorry if I get a little emotional, I feel like you gave me everything that makes me, well, me, and asked for nothing in return. No one is that generous. What was in it for you, and how can I pay you back?
Mr. Sam's breathing became heavy. Well, he said after some hesitation, I suppose if we're going to do this properly, I'll have to overcome a significant amount of my trepidation. I haven't felt this anxious about something in years. She chuckled.
I'd be the last person on Luminar to judge you, Mr. Sam.
Mr. Sam sighed, still trembling. Under his breath, he muttered,
Ilya the Wise, may your memory give me courage.
Finally, he said,
Starlight, you know that Shroud's Guise thing that Erasmus, uses?
Yeah.
He grabbed Liv's hand in the middle of the table.
There was a prototype. It isn't used as much nowadays, on account of,
she winced.
Mr. Sam, you're squeezing kinda hard.
Point being, it wasn't popular because it was stored in sunglasses, and you couldn't use it for a disguise that wasn't wearing sunglasses. I was on an important mission when we first met and was wearing it. It's called the Mechanism for Realistic Sight-Actuated Metacloaking, or Mr. Sam. A nervous chuckle. I suppose it's a miracle you never thought to look it up on Lumapedia, but I did order the articles wiped a few years ago.
Something in Liv's ribcage gained several hundred pounds in weight. Mr. Sam's hand felt cold on her fingers.
Go on, he said with a toothy and desperate grin. Take the glasses off. You need to be the one to do it.
The blood drained from Liv's face.
I gotta go. Slasher's having a Christmas party and
take my glasses off.
His grip on Liv's hand tightened.
Please,
he spat. Her free hand trembled. Her thumb and forefinger edged ever closer to his face.
Okay,
she said to herself.
Stay cool. I have no idea what's going on, but Mr. Sam's probably going through a rough patch. This is either another one of his pranks or a cry for help. The latter I can help him through, and the former I'm gonna laugh my ass off. Maybe this is a pull-my-finger type thing. There's no logical reason to be this terrified right now. So, stop. Just stop being scared.
She swiped off the sunglasses. Liv was immediately met with the crackling of plasma, the shattering of outdated holographic filters, Liv, steel glasses, Mr. Sam, -5, unequipped, and the hungry stare of Prince Raphael Koschei.
Hello, Starlight, said Raphael.
Liv wrestled her hand free and edged her seat back.
Where's Mr. Sam? She asked. What the fog did you do to him?
He never left your side, said Raphael. Look past all your childish indignation, and you know it's the truth.
Liv stared at the floor, her voice lowered as if to keep from raising it. Any slight increase in volume, and her screaming and cursing would never end.
You still didn't answer my question,
she said.
Why go to all this trouble to lie to me?
Raphael stood up, leaning against the table with both hands.
Starlight, I can't help but feel a tad annoyed by your lack of...
Answer my question, Raphael!
Liv dimmed her eye fires and sighed.
Fuck it. I'm a functioning adult. I can just listen to his little confession, flip him off, leave, cry it out, and plan violent revenge for the new year. It's not like he can piss me off anymore.
As if to prove that last thought extremely wrong, Raphael knelt next to Liv, holding her hand again.
I'm breaking all sorts of security clearance by saying this, but my heart is ready. In a year from now,
My father will abolish death forever. The method has been tested and retested over and over for hundreds of years, and there's no chance it'll fail. Imagine, no more death. That means no more killing.
Great, cool, don't care. Answer my vogging quest.
Let me finish! No more killing means world peace. World peace means I can finally retire. And retirement,
Raphael, answer the vogging question,
means that unless I wish to go insane from an immortality of boredom, I need to find a bride worthy of eternal marriage. That's why I stole your mask, to save you the trouble of giving it to me.
Critical hit. 999,999 damage to Liv's faith in humanity. There was no sound but the muffled caroling outside.
You're not thrilled,
said Raphael, genuinely confused.
I was 10,
said Liv, barely over a mumble.
And you're saying you looked at a scared preteen girl in a courtroom and thought to yourself, without a shred of irony, I'm gonna marry that.
Don't be ridiculous. I wasn't in love with you then. Just what do you take me for? But from when I passed you in the courthouse and caught the smell of your hair, I knew for certain you'd grow up to be perfect. And now look at yourself.
He stood back as if to admire his painting.
The edgy little mall rat with a hidden heart of gold, not afraid to give someone a broken nose to protect her friends. My every boyish fantasy come to life. You even helped defeat a Dark Lord, exceeding my expectations for you tenfold. You were a success beyond anyone's imagination, and your reward is a never-ending dream of bliss and ecstasy at my side. I suppose this also answers the how can I pay you back portion.
Raphael waited for a hint of a smile, receiving none.
Perhaps I should give you a moment to let this sink in, he said. I know you'll see this with a clearer head once you've had a nice cup of...
Liv stood up, her body rigid, fists at her sides. She stared at Raphael with her eye fires wide and blazing red. With a flat, steady voice, every syllable slightly overpronounced, she gave Raphael's proposal its answer.
You belong in a morgue.
With that, she made her way to the door. Raphael, teleport self. In a flash, Raphael was against the door, blocking her exit. Baring rows of teeth, he stood glaring, both eyes twitching.
Out of my way, said Liv.
This isn't you,
stammered the prince, pointing a shaking finger.
I didn't teach you this.
I said, out of my way. You're no hero of Luminar. You're just a sick bastard who thinks he can manipulate...
No. It wasn't supposed to be like this. It never went this wrong with the others.
What others?
This ungrateful little bitch isn't my Liv. Who's been corrupting you? Was it the war criminal, huh? How's Slasher doing? He's the one who's been teaching you how to turn my devotion into some imaginary problem, isn't he? Isn't he, huh? Funny how that works. Does Erasmus know my manipulation is the only reason you're not in vogging prison right now?
Angry as she was, Liv couldn't help but chuckle at how much of an idiot Raphael had made of himself.
I can see through your crap on my own. Besides, Slasher's done more for the Empire in 5 months than your creepy ass has done in 500 years. Maybe you could learn a thing or two from Raphael. Slap.
Liv stumbled as she felt the blow, but she didn't fall.
I'm the one with your mask, Starlight, said Raphael. You don't make the rules anymore.
Black plumes of smoke poured from between Liv's clenched teeth. It should be noted here that of the most famously bad decisions of early 53rd century Ares, there are three undisputed leaders in the field. The reopening of Lake Murderworm as a spot for freshwater clam diving, the first annual Fire Walk for Diabetes event, a 10K run through the Ashen Trough Desert in winter clothing, That one time Raphael slapped Liv. Granted, in the future, a few Raphael apologist scholars would hypothesize that it was a planned method of suicide by Mystic in reaction to the existential horror of Project Rubedo's final phase. Of course, said scholars would be generally regarded as complete arseweasels. Meanwhile, the Christmas carolers in the festival below sang,
"You'd better watch out, you'd better not run, and bullets won't work, don't reach for that gun, Santa's gonna come in your house."
Liv, Rhea Strad.
"He's making a list, the names of his lice, his clothes are all made of mummified mice, Santa's gonna come in your house."
The Black Knight has awoken.
"He sees you when you're sleeping, that's sleep paralysis."
Raphael, voice of the savior. But it failed.
"Who cares if you've been bad or good? Just be glad you still exist." "Oh, you better watch."
Live. Defenestrate. The song was mercifully cut short by the sound of a shattering window from the 17th floor of the building behind them. One slowly approaching scream later, the Prince of Celsior, covered in blood, plopped on the ground. A crowd huddled around. Whispers. The occasional shriek.
"Is he dead? Are you okay, Raphael? Is that really him? Maybe he's a cosplayer. If you're not dead, can I have your autograph?"
The prince's arms trembled as he pried himself from the cold pavement and broken glass, standing up. He clutched his shattered ribs.
Merry Christmas,
said Raphael to the crowd. Blood dripped from his mouth with every syllable. A purple light shone from above. Otherworldly snarling. The hum of a levitation spell. The shadow of a crystal-armored witch goddess. The onlookers fled, with some wishing Raphael good luck in the coming battle. Had it been a battle and not a murder, that might have been a welcome sentiment. Before he caught sight of the Riestrad's glow reflecting from the pavement, Raphael's bladder was full. Was. Live. Die, 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 die! A mote of purified shadows, no bigger than a golf ball, floated from Liv's right hand. She hurled it into Raphael's back. Once it landed, Liv clenched her fist. Petrify! Raphael's flesh and clothes turned to white marble, which crumbled into 73 brittle shards. Murdered Prince Ra... She clenched her fist again. Muramorph! The shards turned into 73 diseased rats, which scurried through the marketplace in every direction. Another clench. Harder. Life rot. The rats screeched in unison as they all went into cardiac arrest. Another. Liquefy. Their carcasses became 73 puddles of grayish-brown rat sauce. The puddles slid across the pavement and fused into a Raphael-sized pile of slime in the market center. Harder. Homunculize! The liquid took the color of Raphael's skin. His body was reborn to the world as an unsorted lump, and no part of him was where it belonged. He screamed with all 17 of his new mouths.
Harder.
Ignite. His new body caught fire from the inside.
Harder.
Singularity. The burning Raphael thing folded inward upon itself, until all that was left of the Hero of Luminar was a charred glob of flesh sitting in a teaspoon of blood. Raphael is now 700% dead.
Harder.
But nothing happened.
Again.
Nothing happened.
More.
Liv clenched her fist again and again, draining the spell of any last drops of hatred. But the well had run dry, and she could only cause the last remaining Raphael McNugget to nudge left a few times. Somewhere in Kobelheim, a fruit fell from the apocalypse tree. 10 now remained. Liv's hands trembled in their jagged metallic gloves.
Okay. So I just assassinated the Hero of Luminar, she thought. No biggie. Just this is the most doomed I've been in my...
Live. Denial.
No choice. I had no choice. It was the only way, no choice. Yeah, self-defense. It was all in self-defense.
A cry from a middle-aged man behind the chocolates booth rang out.
You killed him! You actually killed Prince Raphael!
Live. Anger.
Shut up!
And now he's dead! Gone forever!
Liv looked, and Chocolate's man ducked back under his table.
And you got to be the first one to announce it. Are you proud? Is stating the blatantly goddamned obvious the one thing you're good at? Great job making it about you, jackass. Now shut your mouth before I weld your lips to a pig's ass with my mind.
Police sirens cried out in the distance, approaching. Liv, bargaining.
Okay, breathe. Think, Livy girl. You're a dangerous outlaw now, and you know at least one other. I gotta fly out of here and find Slasher. Then, I don't know, maybe he'd think up one of his tricky escape plans. Maybe I could...
He's never coming back,
said Chocolate's man. Live. Depression. Strike that. Anger, too. Reloaded.
One more word out of you and I'll...
He was the hero of Luminar! And you really, truly took his life!
Liv's armor grew darker. Her eye fires went from purple to pure black, as if the flames were made of smoke.
Wowee, wow! Dead!
Added Chocolate's man, for not everyone is born with the gift of self-awareness, and even more will die without it. Liv, acceptance. Strike that, feral Riastrad. Rest assured, Liv did have another clever threat prepared for the hapless chocolatier. It was supposed to be something about Captain Obvious walking the plank. But before she could speak, her Riastrad's armor cracked. The skull mouth on her faceplate opened into a wicked smile with fangs 6 inches long. In a numb rush of heat and pinpricks, Liv's body and the armor became one and the same. Her head was 12 feet off the ground. The black crystals duplicated, adding more and more layers to her armor until they became scales. Dragon wings, horns, a whip-like tail. For the next few hours, she forgot her old name, Nidhogg has awoken, and lost the ability to identify nouns other than meat. LNN. It sure is the news. Established 4309 AL. lnn.co.ari/122311cft.html. Breaking! Prince Raphael Koschei, Hero of Luminar, has been assassinated. Updated 12-23-5211 at 11:58 AR Pro Standard Time. Imperial City. The Horatio County Coroner's Office has confirmed that, at approximately 10:42 p.m., Prince Raphael Koschei died from injuries consistent with acute thaumaturgical bodily eschatologicalization, colloquially known as expletive trocution. He was 523 years old. The murder took place at the Hurley Avenue Christmas Market 18 minutes before closing. Following the murder, 17 bystanders were injured by the suspect during her escape, but no other fatalities than the prince have been reported. The perpetrator has been identified as 19-year-old Olivia May Mattapang, a mystic and a member of the previous Chosen Three campaign. She remains at large and is believed to be hiding in the historic Swoonies building. A manhunt is currently underway. Mattapang's motive appears to be the prince's rejection of her sexual advances. House Koschei has yet to release a statement on the prince's death. Crown Princess Pamina is expected to give an address to the Empire tomorrow morning regarding this sudden tragedy. The involvement of the Mad Elf has been suspected, but not confirmed. This is a developing story. Details forthcoming.
Due to the unparalleled heroism of the victim in this story, LNN is legally obligated to offer the following statement. If you or someone you know is experiencing severe psychological trauma from the Hero of Luminar's death, you don't have to suffer in silence. Sheltering Fist Counseling Services, a division of Koscheis Psychological Solutions, is always here to lend a hand. Visit shelteringfist.co.cel to speak with a pre-scripted therapy chatbot today for just 10 G per second. Live counselors available with the addition of a plus 0.5% compound interest rate. Can't afford therapy? Visit tempme.co.cel and we can connect you to the nearest available high-risk hard labor positions in less than 24 hours. Behind a crowd of gawkers, through a meat wall of cops barking orders, 29 police cars, 7 armored SWAT vans, and 4 Templars in power armor, there stood the dusty gates to Swoonies, an abandoned department store. When there were still steam engines and unironic monocles, Swoonies was the fashion capital of Ares. Now, thanks to a buyout, several zoning disputes, and legions of 60-year-olds crying, "But it's a landmark!" Swoonies was empty and undemolished. For 300 years, it had been a rotting 10-story cyst upon the otherwise scenic M-City skyline. Still, an iconic cyst. Now its only residents were a few destitute squatters, several thousand rats in the basement, and Mystic Liv, the prince killer herself, in the fifth hour of a tense standoff with the police. Inquisitor Mats, one of the armored Templars, stood at the department store's gate for any sign of Liv making a sudden appearance. But in truth, he had doubts that this thing in the abandoned store was Liv to begin with. It was true that the Riastrad changed a Mystic's appearance, but the now infamous Ular Tube footage of the Pyrite Palace incident's live stream showed that her ascended form was a knight in black armor. The knight was the one that killed Raphael as well. Any of the terrified witnesses could tell you that. On the other hand, the thing hiding in Swoonies was a 3-meter-tall winged gargoyle, only suggestively human, and covered in black crystals. Its last appearance was 30 minutes ago, when it jumped from the fifth-floor window and dived through gunfire to break into a liquor store. 10 seconds later, it flew back into Swoonies with an armful of pilfered vodka. The Inquisitor shook his head. Maybe this demon was a diversion summoned up by the real Liv while she made her escape. But even so, an alcoholic gargoyle in downtown Imp City was an emergency in and of itself. Still, dangerous as this demon was, charging in would have led to too much damage to the historic Swoonies building. The noise from the crowd intensified, and the Inquisitor turned away from the door. Spectators parted to clear a path, then police. Was it royalty, or just a very powerful personality? The answer, neither. It was a greencoat, one of House Koschei's elite soldiers. His gas mask and green latex trench coat reduced the cries of the crowd to hushed whispers. A high-tech rifle, one of the dreaded Medusa guns that could turn living flesh into toxic acrylic, sat in his arms. The green coat made a beeline for the gate, and Inquisitor Mats stepped in his path.
"This area is restricted," said the Inquisitor. "Identify yourself." "I am designated green coat number 12, said the soldier, "and this area is restricted to me. His Majesty's son is dead, and you've taken too long to apprehend his killer. I've been ordered to take control of this operation and terminate the Mystic myself." "Really now? Do you have a warrant of summons?" "I have it right here."
Shouldering his gun for a minute, the greencoat pulled Ira Gualtieri's cell phone out of his right pocket. Without bothering to turn it on, he pressed it to the side of his gas mask.
"Hello, Your Majesty. This Templar here says we don't have enough paperwork to avenge your son's..."
"It's fine. Go ahead," said the Inquisitor.
He then proceeded to use all 4,000 horsepower of the suit's leg servos to power Sulk away in shame. Greencoat number 12 nodded. Scarcely after he placed a hand on the rotting wooden door,
"Greencoat!"
It was one of the policemen near the back of the barricade.
Number 12 paused for a second and turned to the police barricade.
Hmm?
The officer grinned and folded his arms.
On behalf of the Imperial City Police Department, send the bitch to hell!
Behind the mask, the green coat's eye twitched and his lip stiffened. He pointed to the officer. Ira, violence won't solve anything. Use your words.
That man is a pedophile,
said number 12. Critical hit. Having made his way to the lobby of Swoonies, Greencoat number 12 finally began to feel sick in the armor of a Celsioran death squad leader. Ira, decloak. With a flash of holographic nonsense, Greencoat number 12 became Ira once again. Well, that went suspiciously smoothly, he said to himself. Though if a Greencoat actually shows up, I'm vogged. What? Number 12 isn't here. He's off in Crapsville getting more crap. You've got an imposter. Stick to the plan, Ira. 1. Find Liv. 2. Have her play dead. Maybe she knows some magic for that. Recloak. 3. All right, boys, got her. But first I need to bring her corpse back to the Koscheis so that they can make a hunting trophy. 4. Escape to the Doom Wagon, decloak. 5. Recloak and grab her some buffalo wings or something. She's had a rough day. Ira sighed. He leaned against a tarnished bronze statue, lost in thought. Speaking of which, why'd she even kill Raphael? Not that I mind. Dude's a corrupt bastard who tried to have me lobotomized. But I thought she was gonna go see Mr. Sam. Unless she walked into some sort of ambush, and Raphael was the one who took her mask, which means... His eyes widened, his teeth ground, and a cold, invisible anvil rested against him. He reached a sickening conclusion, and he very much wanted to be wrong.
Ho, 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 yeah, no. Vog that. Vog him. Yikes, yikes, 1,000 times yikes, god's damn, nope, 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 not cool. Had it coming. Where's his grave gonna be? Gotta piss on it. Gonna have Dad and Titania piss on it, too. I gotta find Liv. Now.
Ira bolted from the statue and made his way up the marble stairs, then into the hollow central atrium. All 10 floors could be seen there, girded by rusty iron railings and jagged figures of Art Deco goddesses. In a dried marble fountain filled with last century's newspapers, a homeless woman sat smoking a cigarette. She glanced at Ira, saw the worried expression on his face, and mumbled,
"She's on the 5th floor."
Ira nodded. As he ran toward the grand staircase, he unpocketed a wad of 20 G-notes from his fight money and placed them next to the woman. "Thanks, ma'am." As he left, she called out to Ira.
You know I'm just gonna buy drugs, right?
Well-earned drugs. Once he reached the 3rd floor, Ira was already out of breath. And my chronic necrolic poisoning rears its ugly head. Maybe I'll just take a quick breather and... A hypothetical image suddenly entered his mind. Liv, sitting on the floor of an empty store, alone and quietly sobbing. God's vogging, damn it. He drew the schiavona, held it above his head, and imagined the hilt to be the landing rail of a runaway helicopter. Giving his legs a rest, he darted through the air towards the 5th floor.
Now, you may be thinking to yourself, wow, being a mystic is just the best. I can create my own black magic instead of buying destruction spells from the Koscheis. And I can see all sorts of colors that don't exist. But what's the catch? Well, plenty. But let's start with the big one. Riastrad. Riastrad, also known as warp spasm or battle trance, is a state of dangerously heightened magical strength in mystics, triggered by intense emotions. While there have been very rare cases of trained professional mystics gaining total control of the Riastrad state at will, The more common result is, sadly, a berserk killing spree. Due to the fact that second-degree murder is generally discouraged by most legal jurisdictions, the Riastrad state should be avoided at all costs. If you believe you are at risk of entering a Riastrad, follow these simple steps. 1. Isolate yourself from others for as long as you need. In extreme cases, consider taking up religious monasticism. The Brotherhood of the Miserably Cloistered could always use another pair of folded hands. 2. If you feel a Riastrad coming on in a public place, do not let others know you're experiencing a potential battle trance. This will incite panic. Instead, scream, "Gosh golly gee, I just pooped my pants!" at the top of your lungs. Not only is this a well-known coded message to other mystics in the area that you need help, it will also prevent vulnerable civilians from coming within 10 feet of you. 3. In the rare event that you do enter a Riastrad, remember the acronym TOAD. T, take deep breaths, and maintain calm until help arrives. Remain in one place. O, only move or take action if your safety or the safety of others is threatened. A, avoid using any magic or giving into any violent impulses until the trance naturally wears off. If this doesn't work, get D, drunk. Sharply increasing your blood alcohol level is the only guaranteed means to force a Riastrad to end. The reason for this is unclear, but believed to have something to do with the mystic spirit's use as the mascot of the 22nd century temperance movement. Witchy McKenzie's Handbook for Law-Abiding Mystics. By the time Ira caught sight of Liv, she was sitting on the floor of an abandoned furniture outlet. In lieu of her mask, she wore a dusty rag with eye holes cut out, something she tore off a store mannequin. Rather than crying, she was chugging a half-empty fifth of Monsieur Tovarish 80 proof, the third of two broken ones on the floor. A pile of full bottles sat in the corner. With every gulp, the black crystal wings growing from her jacket shrunk. Ira smiled a little, if only out of relief. Well, aside from the chance of treatable alcohol poisoning, she seems to be okay. Liv dropped the bottle, wincing and gagging from the taste. Once Ira was sure she wouldn't choke when startled, he sat down next to her. Ira, super secret password. "Have you ever heard of the Beast of Mount Calibri?" he asked. Rule number one of Ira's life in hiding. There is no actual Beast of Mount Calibri. It's actually a very pleasant and beast-free mountain and good for picnics. She turned to Ira.
"Oh, hey, Slasha,"
she chortled through her delirium.
"I'm so plastered, what I can't feel is my brain and stuff. Keeps the Riastraw from coming back."
"Yeah, I can see that," she chuckled.
"Gods, I love saying words."
"Me too. Let's get you back to the bus." Liv fell backward onto the floor, still laughing.
"Back to the bus," she sang. "Back to the bus, gonna back into a bus, suck the exhaust pipe, I am the asphyxiator. Guitar solo."
Ira tried to memorize that for potential inside jokes later and grabbed her arm. "All right, let's go. Do you need me to help you up?" Suddenly, she sprang up, standing, stumbling.
"Slasher, there's something important I gots for telling you."
Ira stood up with her, trying to stabilize her. "I heard about Raphael. Did he hurt you?"
"He ain't too vog. Tried to, though, so I murderized him. You, on the other..."
She pointed to Ira, poking him in the right eye.
"My bad. Anywho, you're the only guy person other than myself who's as much criminal as me.
Yeah, sorry, I don't think you've beaten my public enemy ranking just yet, said Ira, rubbing his aching eye.
You're wrong, but what if? Anywho, both criminals, both in danger. Which means there's only one way we can get out of this thing safe-like.
And that is? Liv grabbed him by the shoulders, staring into his face. Her eye fires were pale gold, as they had only been a few times before.
We need to run off to Kamenaland or summit, get married, adopt like 12 border collies, and die in each other's arms when we're 83.
Ira, internal screaming. Then she projectile vomited all over Ira's sweater and passed out. Liv was KO'd. Ira stood there, blinking, with an armful of dormant Liv for a good minute.
Well, that happened.
15 minutes and a few hasty cleaning spells later, Ira learned how to cast Laundromancy just the other week, and it's been all kinds of useful. No progress, save for the magical destruction of a king's ransom of Liv Barf, had been made. As Liv lay on the floor, Ira sat in silence at a loss for ideas. A serious wrench had been thrown in his rescue plan. Until that day, it never occurred to Ira how weak his leg muscles were. Granted, his arm muscles, though thin, were dense and sturdy. He could thank years of fencing training for that. But what remained of his 1.5 legs was weak, gangly, and supple. Depending on which physical therapist you'd ask, it was either inevitable from the toxic Medusa gun wound that took his right leg, or the product of laziness. Either way, several attempts to princess carry the unconscious Liv had ended with buckling knees, stumbles, and terrified searching for bruises. Over the shoulder was right out, too. The last thing she needed right now was whiplash. So there he sat, deeper into what-ifs and brainstorming than he had been in at least a week. His nails dug into his scalp. Damn it, come on! The orange and blue hints of sunrise peeked in through the dusty windows. It only further reinforced to Ira that even if he was out of ideas, time had no idea of going easy on him. Neither did the impatient cops and Templars outside. An immensely stupid thought trailed into his head at the last second. Better than nothing. Ira. Contingency Zeta 9 Charlie, sittin' pretty. He reached into his duffel bag. Roll of duct tape? Check. Dagger? Check. Make sure I filled the dagger with psychic energy. He held one of his spare daggers, the cheap ones he could throw, then opened his palm and focused, pretending the dagger was a particularly heavy hummingbird. With a flash of green light, it floated in the air. Check. Liv? It never occurred to Ira until then how much Liv snored when she was unconscious. It was always quieter when she slept. Here, an asthmatic walrus would have been more discreet. Check. Also, why do I think that's cute? Questions for later. Here goes. Successfully duct-taped a dagger to Liv's butt. Now, as the inventor of the flu vaccine said, one more shot. Ira, Princess Carrie. Ira groaned and grit his teeth as he lifted Liv one more time. He visualized her makeshift ass blade as a third hand, strong enough to bear most of her weight. To those of you wondering why he didn't just have the dagger and one of his hands switch places for efficiency's sake, she is unconscious, and you are a sad little man. Within seconds, Ira found himself carrying only 25 pounds of Liv's collective 182. He sighed with satisfaction at how easy it had become, and or that he was honest to God's princess carrying someone he was attracted to. And it got weird. Whatever. Next step.
back into the green coat disguise and...
Contact!
Unknown. Paint target. Unknown. Plasma barrage. Unknown. Grenade launcher. Ira closed his eyes, sighed through his nose, and ran. Merry Vogging Christmas. Chapter 3. Follow me, set me free. Trust me, and we will escape from the city. Henry David Thoreau, Walden. lumapedia.co.ari/friar_noah_tamino/. Friar Noah Tamino. Notice. As of September 4th, 5211, this article has been in the top 20 most vandalized pages on Lumapedia. As such, it has been locked for editing until further notice. Remember, while user-curated, Lumapedia is meant to be objective, impartial, and Lord Monty did nothing wrong, strike that, professional. Noah Tamino is a Celsioran licensed healer, friar of the Church of Ares, and former cleric of the 1042nd Chosen Three campaign. And as of the upcoming Death March, Lord Monty's bitch number 51,279. Strike that. Following his team's victory over Dark Lord Monastatos, Lord Monty Jones, Friar Noah has become an outspoken public critic of Celsior's Koschei administration and has made several appearances on talk shows and news programs to denounce them. Ulartube, The Tardy Show with Mick Pendragon, Clip, Good Mr. K, if you could please stop murdering elves, that'd be very nice of you. Friar Noah is cuckolded on the regular by, strike that, engaged to Crown Princess Pamina of Ares, whom he has known since childhood. The wedding has been scheduled for January 22, 5212. In addition, Wolf mourns not the rabbit, hashtag GU, hashtag Monty lives. Strike that. Friar Noah Tamino's alarm had been set for 10 o'clock a.m. that morning. Today was going to be another one of his mental health days. Noah had been having a lot of those this month, for the same reason that he was drifting from motel to motel, splurging on comfort items, and considering joining a monastery to atone for his sins. That reason, for the sake of Noah's friends and their tendency to fret over his well-being, was something he'd promised himself to keep secret. He couldn't lie. Not under penalty of instant death from his magical beads. But that didn't mean he couldn't keep a secret. At any rate, the time was 5:03 in the morning, and Noah was curled up in a king-sized bed. He'd already forgotten the name of the motel, but it was in the Imperial City suburbs, a very safe distance away from the palace, and the continental breakfast had those lovely poppy seed muffins. Plus, he was in his lion pajamas. Another fight money splurge, complete with tail, mane, ears, and even pockets. Best of all, the hotel lobby had zero framed pictures of the Crown Princess. None whatsoever. A violation of imperial law, possibly, but also a welcome respite from the constant reminders. Today was the early morning of Christmas Eve. Noah's foolproof plan was to order pizza for all three meals, have a few good cries, and turn the news off to watch old Christmas specials. In the name of Argo, Raphith, Galgalim, St. Titus, St. Aresia, St. Cyrus, St. Darius, St. Charlotte, St. What's-His-Face, St. Everyone Else, and even the Voice Highmost, today would be a good vogging day. Then, 5:04 a.m. happened. Noah woke up with a yelp as his phone vibrated on the nightstand. His heart raced as his eyes darted around the dark room. Why wasn't there a nightlight? He had made it very clear that he needed one. Whatever, only the gods can judge. For monsters. He grabbed his phone, answering it with a hasty, "Hello, this is Noah, and I love you?"
"Yo, jackass, this is Misha."
"Hello, Mr. Gualtieri. What time is it?"
"It's my son and future daughter-in-law are in mortal danger o'clock. I need you in the doom wagon, and I need you there yesterday. We're in Riverview, right outside the Artemisia building. Oh, and bring the astral flute thingy. Titania says you'll need it.
Noah
grimaced.
Well, I mean, I'm pretty far away from Riverview right now, and I've had a very rough night. But I wouldn't worry too much. Ira's super-duper clever, and Livy could break a dragon in half with her magic. I'm sure they'll think of some...
Your air canal, a funnel, battery acid.
I'll be right over, Mr. Gualtieri. See you soon.
Noah hung up and let out a heavy sigh. He placed his palms together and closed his eyes. Noah, postponial lamentation.
Lord Argo, holy bearer of the Golden Fleece, hear my cry.
He whispered.
With respect and adoration, I must put off my prayers of greeting the day until a few hours from now, being Mr. Gualtieri is very cross and needs my immediate help. Thank you for your patience and understanding. In the holy name of the Wheel, Flame, and Fleece, fiat.
Success. Argo is literally a sheep and doesn't speak human, but your kind words are appreciated. 543. The Artemisia building, once a newspaper HQ and printing press, now pricey condos, glowed orange from the rising sun in the distance. As such, the gargoyles on the rooftops looked extra goylier. Below, the doom wagon sat idling. Titania stood outside, smoking one of Misha's cigars. Noah came rushing up to her with his staff in one hand and the astral flute in the other. For the record, he was still in his lion pajamas.
Sorry I'm late,
he said, charging toward the bus door. Titania stood in the doorway, blocking his path.
Sir Noah, my dear, we have little time. My premonition grows bleaker by the second. You must get to Liv and Ira now.
Noah tilted his head.
Well, Metro's running on a holiday schedule, I'm afraid. That's why it took me so long to...
Never mind that. You have the astral flute, do you not?
Right here.
Do you remember the fingering for E?
Fitting his staff into his right elbow, Noah pressed his fingers against five of the holes. For the past 2 months, Titania had been Noah's de facto sacred cobalt flute tutor. He now knew a few more thaumaturgically useful songs than hot cross buns.
Good, very good. Now close your eyes, blow softly, and hold it until your location changes.
He nodded. Noah, this is what E sounds like. As the tone played, Titania placed a palm on Noah's scalp, with the other hand raised to the air. With a low chant in E,
Narosh Kalem Lutrachisen Forel Gati Kremlau.
Titania, warrior's summons. May the blessed winds carry him to victory. Noah disappeared. Misha chuckled from the doorway.
Holy nutballs, babe! Did you just vaporize Noah? I mean, I'm not complaining too much, but just don't tell Liv, yeah? 'Cause that'll be another recliner.
No such luck, said Titania. And could you be a little gentler with him, darling? I heard your conversation.
All right, sorry. He's sensitive, I get that.
She sighed.
Not just that, I'm afraid. I've been sensing a new deep sorrow in him of late. He hides it well around humans, but a kobold can smell emotion.
Really? Poor fella. Wait, is that last part a metaphor?
No. I nearly had to hold my nose around him. It's like olives and burning hair.
Noah, warrior's summons. When Noah opened his eyes and pocketed the flute, he was in a dark room full of moth-bitten braziers. Withered relics from a time when they were still called braziers. An old wooden sign read, For the Working Girl's Night of Pelvic Profanity. Next to it was a lithograph of a monocled dandy in a top hat giving the okay sign. Looking spiffy, sexual Sally. Trademark. Noah winced. 1/3 of a second, and he already needed a priest. That had to have been a record. A flash of war pixels came from the corner of his eye, and Noah turned. If Titania could have smelled his emotions now, he'd have been absolutely putrid. Ira was there. He was unconscious, pixel fading, and seconds from death. He sat in the corner with his arms around Liv, who was either also unconscious, or a second option that Noah chose to aggressively ignore. Noah, restore 3. Noah's instincts as a healer took over. He took the staff in both hands, cocked it like a shotgun, oh come on, just let him have this, and shot a spark of white light into each of their heads. Ira and Liv recovered all HP, but remain unconscious on account of being extremely tired. They were still alive. Noah sobbed from relief and shouted, "Argo be praised!" Of course, this would mean that whoever was attacking them might hear. But if you were under the impression that Noah was a particularly smart healer, you haven't been paying attention. A distorted voice from a Templar's power armor echoed from several floors down.
"Who's there?" "It's coming from the lingerie shop."
Noah jumped, and quickly realized his own likelihood of joining this cuddle pile of the doomed. Even if he rejuvenated Liv and Ira, the three of them stood no chance against...
Wait, how many are there? Focus, Noah. Count the stompy noises.
11 zillion Templars. The only option left was to carry the two of them out and revive them in a safer place. Besides, having recovered his HP, Ira would awaken on his own in a minute or two. But first, Noah had to get another terrible idea out of the way. He slammed his staff on the ground, focusing a powerful spell on himself. Noah, speed buff. Speed buff. Now just 4,999.99 G. Class, white magic. School, transcendence. Skill level, intermediate. Effects. Causes a temporary, average 30 seconds, burst of speed in the caster or an ally. MP cost, 30. Professional uses. Combat medics, first responders, couriers, food delivery. Directions. Open scroll to permanently memorize spell. Casting stance A5 with hands or wand, or C32 with two-handed instrument. Cast in an open area. Warning. Recommended maximum speed stat increase is 10. Increasing speed by over 20 points can lead to uncontrollable damage to self and others. Speed buff scroll label, Koscheis Thaumaturgicals. Noah's speed stat increased by 174. Noah, the poor bastard, was now the fastest man on Luminar. He froze in place. The slightest sudden movement might have let loose enough kinetic energy to atomize the whole building.
Deep breaths. In. Hold. Out. In. Hold. Out. Pretend I'm walking through water. I can do this.
Over the next 20 seconds, Noah slipped his arms around Ira and Liv and hoisted them. His muscles tried to jump out of his skin with every move. But despite feeling every bit of evidence to the contrary, there he stood, with both of his unconscious friends over his shoulders. He trembled. His knees threatened to buckle into a knot.
10 more seconds. Just tiptoe down the hallway into another room. Not through any walls or windows, and wait for the spell to cool down. Then cast again, but go easier. That'll work, right? 7, 6, 5, 4. Hey, that can wasn't here a minute ago.
Inquisitor Metz, smoke bomb. Noah was spooked.
Got him! Move in!
Noah, flee. In just 3 steps, Noah was airborne, 2 miles away, and shrieking. LNN. It sure is the news. Established 4309 AL. LNN.co.ari /122411hwi.html. Breaking! Prince Raphael's assassin and the mad elf escape 5-hour standoff, still at large. Imperial City. After a thorough search of the historic Swoonies building in the Riverview Quarter, the Arisian Knights Templar has confirmed that Olivia May Matapang and Erasmus Gualtieri have escaped. Following confirmation of the disappearance at 6:30 a.m., Inquisitor Hector Matz met with reporters in a press conference. Manual searches returned nothing, said Matz. In addition, our auto-oracles have detected no cloaking magics, residual war molecules, or signs of human life, save for the search parties already present at the time. The Mad Elf was initially suspected to have played a part in the assassination of Prince Raphael. This was confirmed when he was sighted within the building, attempting to help Matapang. A brief battle ensued, during which Gualtieri murdered 3 Templar scouts before receiving non-life-threatening wounds. Though the extent of the elf's involvement is still a matter of speculation, the feature-length biographical drama Prince Destroyer, How Rosy Sex Magic Turned a Mystic into a Demon, has been greenlighted by Koscheis Studios, LLC. The whereabouts of both perpetrators are unknown. However, there have been unconfirmed bystander reports of an object resembling Matapang, Gualtieri, and an unknown third person being launched from a window into the sky northeast of Swoonies. Ira woke up to a stinging light in his eyes, severe wind chill, and the feeling of being upside down. He grumbled. Waking up was his least favorite part of life by far. Okay, Ira, take it slow. Step by step. Sky? Having opened his eyes a little too early, Ira couldn't help but notice the cloud layer above his head, an empty expanse of blue below him, and the thin air of the stratosphere choking his lungs. Sky! I'm in the vogging sky! Why? Hey, that's kind of catchy. Focus! I gotta get out of the sky, or I'll die, in the sky! Unless I can fly, I'm a sky-dying guy! Bye! Ira, wake up slap. Too damaged to self. Yeah, okay, focusing. Ira, blade recall. Ira snapped his fingers and a familiar sword flew into his hand. He pictured the sword as a handheld parachute, and his plummet from the stratosphere slowed to a gentle float. Just then, a shriek of, I need a priest! Faded into the distance below. Noah? Ira pointed the sword downward. Within seconds, he dove through the blind chill of the cloud layer. Next to him, a terrified cartoon lion flickered in and out of the white vapor. On closer inspection, the lion had Noah's face. Explanations can wait. Hang on, Noah! Ira grabbed the lion's tail and sighed in relief to feel its tensile strength, military grade. Noah always was serious about comfort. Ira tied the tail around the hilt of his last pocket knife and convinced himself that the knife was a giant umbrella. Once they reached the bottom of the cloud layer, Ira was hanging from his sword and Noah was hanging from his tail. They sat motionless in the air, with the brownish-gray winding maze of suburban planned communities below them. Ira glared at Noah, waiting for an explanation, and tapping his left foot. With the ground being away on business and all, it was more of a dog-paddling sort of thing. Once Noah sucked a few calming breaths out of the thin air, he managed to speak,
Liv's falling too! You gotta save her!
Ira's heart sank, until he remembered how much duct tape he had used for her butt knife. Ira recalled the shape of the knife and flicked his wrist. Done. Meanwhile, thousands of feet below, a 10-car pileup occurred at the corner of 177th and Lamia in the town of Yawbrook. The cause was disputed, but believed to have had something to do with the sudden and anomalous sighting of a falling girl in the sky. Reportedly, her descent slowed to a glide, stopped, then completely reversed back into the air, ass first. This was later said to be the inspiration for the experimental ska band Smokey Flimbert's 5th concept album, Booty Rocket.
lumapedia.co.ari/Vinny_vulture/. Vinny Vulture. Vinny Vulture, full name Vinston Victor Vladimir Valerian Vava Voom Vulture, is the lead character of the Greatness Gang cartoon franchise by Koschei Media Holdings. Though his appearance has evolved over time, see also Vin Vulture's Extreme Skate Park Radventure, he is most commonly depicted as an anthropomorphic griffin vulture in full evening dress. Vinny and the Greatness Gang comprise a global media empire worth over 30 trillion G. Vinny's catchphrase of "Gee Willicky Woo" is the only trademark in the world protected under penalty of death. In-universe biography. Vinny is a wealthy lounge singer in the Gangly Neck Cabaret in Celsior Central. His band, the Greatness Gang, is composed of Stinky Jim Skunkworth, drums, Vinny's girlfriend Sarsaparilla Carp, keyboards, Theophrastus Bombastus von Possumheim, saxophone and guitar, and the stupid ugly tapeworm, bass. With the power of music, morality, and blind loyalty to the free market, they defend Celsior against the schemes of Dr. Bitters, an evil scientist who is also the Emperor of Rosencrace. The dull little suburb of Yawbrook, population 4,204, just north of the Imperial City, was famous for two things. 1. Greatness Gulch, the smallest of four Vinny Vulture theme parks throughout the Empire. 2. The Yawbrook Goat Plague, which killed 5,000 goats a few centuries ago. Since it was Christmas Eve and Greatness Gulch was closed until next summer, the only real reason to visit Yawbrook was the historic goat graveyard. Even the security staff in Greatness Gulch were off for the holidays. Now I ask you, dear listener, if you were a psychic fencer on the run from the law and you just floated out of the sky into Yawbrook, where would you hide? In the center of Greatness Gulch was a 10-meter-high fiberglass statue of Vinny himself, crooning a silent song into a giant mic stand. Ira and Noah sat hidden on the vulture's tongue, with Liv laying down toward the back of his throat. Ira was in a cold sweat, struggling to take deep breaths. Getting the three of them to solid ground had sucked him dry of all his psychic stamina. When he opened his eyes again, Ira saw Noah on the other side of the tongue hanging his head.
"It's all my fault," said Noah, already on the verge of tears. "I should have known better than to use speed buff to get you and Livy out of there. I've never gotten that spell right."
Ira chuckled. "To be fair, neither have I," he said. "And you're kind of forgetting the part where we'd have been dead by now if you didn't show up. Thanks, by the way." That perked Noah back up.
"Oh, well, no problem at all, just my duty as a healer. Now it's your turn."
"My turn to..."
"To explain. Why is Livy wearing that dirty old rag instead of her mask? And why were you two in that department store anyway? It's been closed for decades now, silly."
Ira cringed at the realization. Noah was still in the dark about what happened between Liv and Prince Raphael. And now, the daunting task of breaking the news to Noah's sensitive soul fell on Ira. Noah sensed Ira's discomfort and giggled.
"Okay, okay, I get it. I know you're not gonna, you know, smooch and tell, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, you saucy libertines, you."
"Never say that again," said Ira. "It was... Look, did Liv ever tell you about Mr. Sam?" Noah gasped, clapping both of his hands to his mouth as his eyes filled with galaxies.
"He's the coolest guy ever," said Noah. "He used to hang out with Liv and I all the time when we were in high school. He taught me how to play smickety smackety, and also taught me that most people call it ping pong. Anyway, he's the nicest fella I've ever met. Always polite, smart as a whip, and..."
A grumbling voice from the back of the vulture's tongue. "He's not real." It was Liv's turn to wake up from Noah's earlier healing.
As if on instinct, Ira and Noah scrambled to her. She planted her hands against the statue's tongue and pried herself into more of a sitting position. Then she snapped her fingers to light her eye fires. Live. Ignite.
Mr. Sam isn't real, she said. He was... Oh, fuck!
Just as her vision returned, she covered her eyes with her palm. The light was too much.
Are you all right?
Asked Noah. Just a hangover, said Ira. You got anything for that? Noah shook his head.
Junior prom all over again,
he said, and placed his glowing hand on Liv's head. Noah, morning after. Liv was thoroughly unboozed. Liv continued.
Mr. Sam was just a disguise Raphael was using. It was him the whole time. Raphael saved me from prison. Raphael taught me how to control my powers.
She turned to Noah.
Raphael even taught you how to play ping pong.
Noah stared into his right hand in horror, imagining that the plastic paddle of lies was once again sitting there. Subtlety wasn't his strong suit. Ira, the reveal.
Damn, said Ira. So is that why you killed him?
Noah was paralyzed.
What?
Liv stared out past the vulture's beak into the gray sky and the grayer skyline, focusing on nothing in particular.
Yeah, she said. But not just that. The whole Mr. Sam thing was all part of a plan to seduce me. He was trying to groom me into being his bride.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.